I'm mic'd up, I'm working, yeah? Excellent. So thank you so much for coming along. I hope I can give you a little bit of inspiration for Friday and let you know a little bit about why MEC is working with startups and why it's important. So to kick off, I just wanted to do a little straw poll and find out what you think of when you hear the word startup. So what do you think a startup is? Does anyone want to have a crack at trying to define that? Team size, new business, yeah? Anything else? Anything?
Very small,
so perhaps something like this little guy saying, I'm just a Brazilian beautician's workshop at his house. Do you stop becoming a startup when perhaps you have an HR team or when you have a PA? Or, you know, it's trying to define what a startup is really difficult. That's our first challenge, but there's lots and lots of definitions. You know, our company is like basically Google's still a startup, and that's always up for debate. But how I define a startup is a temporary organization designed to search for repeatable, scalable business model. So it's this idea that actually a startup is something that is still not quite figured out how it makes its money, how its business model should operate. So that's kind of worth bearing in mind. In comparison, this is how I see an established organization, so a company like ourselves and like the clients we work with. These are organizations that have got it. They are like, this is how we make our money, this is how we operate. And you know, the only time we're gonna kind of change things is for sort of new products that our existing business model is not gonna change. So it's worth maybe looking at the landscape. So I'm sure most of you will recognise a lot of the names on this slide. As you go towards the right, these are some homegrown talent as well. So we're way far behind what's happening in the US. The US has had a huge amount of successful startups come out of it. The UK is lagged behind, but I think we're in the last quarter, because we've just been in, there's about $680 million been invested, and it's looking like it's going to go up to about $2 billion this year. So the London market, in terms of investing in these companies, is popping up. You've got companies like TransferWise that just raised in the last couple of months about $52 million. And what they do is they're a sort of peer-to-peer lending startup. So they basically allow you to send money around the world, which traditionally used to cost an absolute fortune. Banks are making a shitload, basically, taking a load of fees off the back of that. And these guys have come up with a way, so if you're trying to transfer pounds to euros, they'll find somebody else that's trying to get euros to pounds, and it's this idea that they match the two, and so you don't have to pay, like you basically reduce the cost hugely. And you know, this is a company that's now taking 2% of the remittance market, and so if you're a big bank, these are the sort of companies that you're looking at thinking, well, actually, these guys are providing way better service to our customers and are starting to take the market. So we have some great companies in the UK. A really good example of something that we call a unicorn in the startup world is a company that's valued over $1 billion. So Uber is actually now valued at something like $41 million, which is absolutely crazy, because that means that it's got a valuation that's 70% more, but it's more than 70% of the Fortune 500 companies, so companies like Hustle and we've all heard of. But funnily enough, Uber, in terms of how much money it makes about $400 million a year, and that's not enough at all for it to be listed on Fortune 500. So it's the idea that these kind of new tech companies are getting valuations that are just out of control, but aren't actually making the money that traditionally you would see with those kind of valuations. So just a sort of interesting point. So that's an example of a unicorn, and then you have super unicorns like these guys here. So what's interesting to know is every kind of decade you have a new company that comes out and kind of explodes into the market, and then off the back of that, lots of new tech and tech products comes out to you. So in the 1960s, you had Semiconductor, which saw Microsoft come up, and Apple was this sort of personalized computer. But kind of in the 1970s, you know, Apple came out, and then kind of went, you know, almost went bust a couple of decades ago, and now it's coming up. So it's this idea that, you know, big companies are still trying to find their place in the market. Cisco, that was the idea of a new networked world, and Google was the kind of age of modern internet, and then Facebook is this idea of new social networks, and they're the kind of key players that really shape what's happening in the market in terms of technology. And you know, your guess is good as mine, but the next one, could it be an Uber? Because I think probably the next big explosion is going to be this idea that you can literally do everything through a mobile app such as Uber. So why does this all matter? Well, every single time we have these new blasts of technology that come out, lots of new companies explode out of them too, and then audiences have changed. So the way our people we try to communicate with, they're using this technology and they're changing the way they behave. So, you know, here's just a few funny slides that I put into here on Friday, but, you know, no, I'm not talking about Twitter, I literally want you to follow me. It's the idea that the only follow that counts is on Twitter. And you've also got this is a, I love this slide, Cameron Howard tweeted, what's wrong with this dude, what is he looking at the world? It's the idea that this guy is the only one actually bothering to look at what's going on in the world. No, the world is mobile, we pretty much do absolutely everything on our phones now, so that's how the audience we've changed. This is quite a funny one as well. This is about eating bacon. If you're eating bacon on Twitter, you're I'm eating bacon. I like bacon on Facebook. I have this feeling of really eating bacon on Twitter. This is where I eat my bacon on Foursquare. Watch me eat my bacon on YouTube. Here's a vintage photo of my bacon on Instagram. Here's a recipe with bacon on Pinterest. I work for Google and I eat bacon on Google Plus. And I'm listening to music about bacon. So again, this is how we communicate, right, through all our social networks. And the final one is wearable tech, right? This is probably, I don't know if you guys saw Jamie Howard's presentation, but you know, this is probably going to take off. And again, it's a new way that consumers are using technology in whatever way they want to use it. But you know, it's the idea that these, our audiences are changing way quicker than big businesses can catch up with. And we have to adapt to that. So what does that mean for non-traditionally digital businesses? So these are very sad slides. So we've got a company like Kodak, which is right at the big, you know, at the forefront of photography, and it just no longer exists. So they made a massive mistake because they dominated the market, they knew digital was coming, they had loads of research, they knew it was coming at them, but they pumped about 90% of their resource still into chemicals and paper. And actually their head of marketing said, you know, we just did not take enough asymmetrical bets on where our next revenue stream was going to come from. They just kind of were focused on what they already did, and suddenly they found the market was dominating, completely changed, and they just could not play catch up enough. And that was the end of Kodak. Similar with BlackBerry, what the hell BlackBerry doing? They were right there at the front, and their share price at about at their peak was like $230. It's now 10 today. And you know, this thing called the iPhone came out and they thought, well, that sounds, you know, we'll leave that and took up people's, you know, personal phones. It's not relevant. We're gonna carry on doing something with, you know, really secure operating systems for businesses and government. And oh, whoops, you know, missed out on a massive, massive opportunity. And a kind of similar thing about Nokia as well. You know, companies who could never, ever have said not be at the forefront of what they're doing. Suddenly they're kind of undercut by new competitors in the market. Another one is Blockbuster and Netflix. So Blockbuster, I mean, I remember walking down High Street and the blue and yellow shop was kind of pivotal and everyone's Friday night, you go and you go and your video and you go with your mates and watch it. And Blockbuster actually disrupted kind of Hollywood. They made it okay for people to be able to watch movies in their own home. And at their peak, they had 60 million customers, they had kind of points of sale across 25 countries. You know, they were doing great. And then suddenly, they were disrupted themselves. Somebody called Netflix came along, and their original model was delivery of DVDs to the post. So you don't have to go to Blockbuster anymore, you can actually just get it sent to your home. And Blockbuster just did not change their model quick enough. They didn't see that coming. And with the rise of the internet, suddenly you can look online, order your DVDs and get them sent to your home. But Netflix had to change, because Netflix actually got to a point where it started to be disrupted and it had to change the business model again to this idea of live streaming and stop with the delivery of DVDs. So again, it's this idea that Netflix was actually able to move and able to change a bit quicker, but you know, that was always kind of born out of the internet platform, and that's partly why. But Blockbuster was kind of leading in its market and then disappeared. Something that's also quite interesting is with Periscope and Meerkat. HBO had an absolute nightmare with these guys because people have been live streaming episodes of Game of Thrones and then the big fight that happened a couple of months ago, and they have just gone apeshit. Like, this is absolutely, you know, you're doing this illegally, we pay so much for rights and broadcasting sports and all sorts of things. So they've, you know, gone to Periscope and tried to start a legal fight. What's interesting is actually whether HBO should, instead of being trying to gobble up these guys or sue them, is whether actually they should be working with them to understand how their business can change and how these new technologies come forward. And there's a good example of MBO, MBS, right? Is that the some big NBC. There you go. So they had like an argument with YouTube when it first launched because they found some content that was on the site from Saturday Night Live, and so you've absolutely got to take it off. Then actually what happened is they helped YouTube come up with a kind of content verification system, so they collaborated and ended up helping YouTube to work with content providers to make sure that the kind of illegal stuff was taken down. And then they formed a really great partnership, and that kind of was the beginning of a really successful partnership between two big players. So it's this idea that actually perhaps you should be working with people who are disrupting the market rather than just trying to sue them. But we've kind of looked at some examples of big companies that are at the top of their game and completely destroyed by competitors. That's not always going to happen. So I'm not saying that every big client that we work with at one point is just going to get some of our business taken away by a startup. What could happen is this idea of unbundling. So this is a kind of chart that shows how Procter & Gamble are being unbundled. You can see lots and lots of little startups out there that are tiny little bits of what P&G are all about. You've got kind of beauty products and shaving products and all sorts of stuff in kind of personal care. But what's happening here is not only are these guys innovating around the product, but they're actually innovating in how they are then sent to consumers. So a lot of these are e-commerce subscription models. And they're targeting consumers in a way that is far more helpful to the consumer that's going to be using these products. So it's this idea that, actually P&G should probably be working with these guys and collaborating with them, because suddenly they might find that slice of their business is actually no longer relevant to their consumers. A little bit about, a bit like the TransferWise example, where that's a slice of banking that banks could lose, and that actually ends up making quite a lot of money. So how have big companies responded to this? Well, they've set up a ton of things called incubators and accelerators, which is a way for big businesses to start working with these new early stage companies and startups. Some of these businesses here have got their own what they call startup accelerators. I came from BBC Worldwide Labs. BBC Worldwide decided that it's gonna open up give away some office space for free to new companies and startups in the kind of digital media space, and work with them and try and get them to do partnerships with BBC and the startup. Barclays, Lewis, Disney, Virgin, really good example. DPD is a delivery service. They've realised that delivery services are being disrupted, so they've opened a lab to work out how they can work with companies, quite frankly, that like Uber, that are actually going to end up disrupting the delivery service. And then you can see kind of running Edge as well. Agencies have been the last of the party, but they are now trying to work with startups too, because ultimately they need to be working with the latest technology and delivering that to their clients. And this is a really good quote from Jeremy Bassett from Unilever. It's basically saying, it is actually the agency's job to bring us new tech in media. We should not be doing this ourselves. As it happens, Unilever are doing it themselves. They've pumped shitloads of money into their something called the Foundry, which is their startup initiative. And that's a massive, massive waste of opportunity for their agency, because they did it as a reaction to saying, well, you guys aren't bringing us new stuff fast enough, so we'll do it ourselves. Just worth keeping in mind. And then a few examples, as we're going to talk through how big businesses and startups have worked together and kind of some of the output from that. So sticking with the Unilever theme, Unilever, one of their products is Nord, and a stock cube business, and they have a huge amount of customers in the emerging markets. The problem with that is people in emerging markets have feature phones rather than smartphones. They're really struggling to find ways in which they can communicate with these guys. So they work with a startup called Digital Genius, which is in the artificial intelligence area, and they came up with this idea of Chef Wendy. So now people in certain parts of the world can text Chef Wendy and say, what's for dinner tonight? And Chef Wendy will text them back with a recipe, which involves using your products. This idea that by using this kind of technology that Unilever just could not build in-house and just didn't have expertise in, they were able to interact with an area of the market that they just couldn't have done before. I don't know if anyone recognise this guy? Funny enough, this is quite similar, I think, to this guy. But basically, this guy is Nick Delosio, and he sold his startup at the age of 17 to Yahoo. The startup was called Summy, sold it for £18 million, so he's having a great time right now. But apparently, he didn't want to join the company, he wanted to finish his A-levels, which was probably but you know, this idea that Yahoo was struggling to combat the mobile world, and suddenly was a great product which would summarise all the news content. And Yahoo saw the opportunity, snapped him up. I mean, the company was about 2 years old, it was tiny, and have started to build and iterate on the product. And then this is something that we did at BBC, so I don't know if anybody uses bbcgoodfood.com to get their recipes. We partnered with a company called Constant Commerce, which allowed all our recipes to become shoppable. So it was a way that we just had a kind of static website that didn't do anything for us. We used a new piece of technology. Kind of relatively early, we were able to kind of manipulate it and make it work for us. And now that means that this site is now a revenue stream for us at BBC, and it means that our, I'm not there anymore, but it means that this is a much more complete proposition to the people that we are talking to. And my final example is a company called Wonlo. Funny, but basically Wonlo are quite similar to Pinterest and Tumblr in that they allow you to collate and collect products, kind of pin them, and then the extra bit they allow you to do is to buy the product straight away. So they've done a partnership with Urban Outfitters, and despite being a fairly unknown name, they've had a huge amount of success in that they've got more followers for Urban Outfitters Wonlo account than on Pinterest and Instagram. So whilst these guys are much smaller, the difference was that people could actually purchase the products straight from the site of Urban Outfitters, which is something that the other providers didn't do. And so it was all about Urban Outfitters kind of trying new products, not just relying on stuff that was already in the market, and then actually receiving benefits from them. So that was just a quick blast through all of the examples. I mean, it's worth saying that what I'm trying to achieve here at MEC is to be help us become an agency that clients feel is bringing in new stuff, and it's bringing in new stuff quickly. So there's a number of things we've set up, including some innovation finders, which means people meet monthly to review startups, and they have then a month to get that to a client. So if anybody is interested in being part of that, do let me know. And then the other thing we're doing is something called a sprint, which will be a 6-month deep dive into a certain area. Not going to be brief specific, it's going to be much kind of wider than that. So, for example, it should be around like beacon technology or smart retail spaces, and we'll get people like Morris who's being involved to be part of it. And that's the way that we say, right, I'm going to go out into the market, find the best technology in this area, find the best startups in this area, and help you to really, really quickly test, partner, scale, and learn from doing a partnership with these guys. So then the two things that we're doing at MEC, we're launching Innovation Pioneers, and we're starting the sprints in July. So if anybody wants to be part of that or is interested in getting involved, do just let me know. But I will leave you with an inspirational quote for your Friday takeaway. But has anybody got any burning questions that you'd like to ask?
There's a risk with startups that they claim something cool. And sorry, I mean, I've had this problem with the pop, the greenhouse for that. They make something cool, but it's not very applicable. And then you just have this great piece of tech that then it just sort of sits on its own and isn't actually that useful for anything. Do you find that like it's a big problem for startup companies?
Absolutely. And some of the founders, I mean, bless them, these startups, they are the brightest people you've ever met. They cannot sell for anything. They can't communicate with people. They struggle to sell their proposition. They struggle to explain their proposition. So you can have the best company in the world, the best tech, but if you can't sell it, you can't make it relevant, it's really tough. That's where I think us as media agency can add value. We can negotiate terms with startups and say, look, we're going to take you to our clients. We're actually going to add some media spark to this because tech is nothing in the media marketing space if it's not got the right messaging around it. And I think that's where every time we see a new company, we need to be working out about how at MEC can we add value to our clients' pairs to do this. And so startups might give X amount of revenue to us as well to help them with their customers. So yes, I see that all the time, but I think it actually provides us an opportunity to make a bit more money out of it.
Do you think it's, I think there's like such a huge difference between startups that are really useful for people, say like Uber is a really useful service, and then also like advertising kind of startups, so like people, companies like Shazam and Blipper and Cinemy, which are all like nice apps, but they're kind of nothing, and clients kind of see through that now.
Yeah.
Do you think that there's a gap for like a big kind of tech innovation that's actually providing value for advertisers rather than kind of being true and being safe with it?
Yeah, I mean, I was in an event this morning on ad tech specifically.
Yeah.
And basically, it's a massively fragmented market. There's lots and lots of tiny little players trying to eat away in a really, really crowded space.
Yeah.
So I think then there's two kinds of innovation. There's kind of small steps innovation, which are kind of nice to have. They're going to blow things away, they're going to tear down, you know, the next blockbuster or whatever. But I think they're important because not only do they get results, but it's also a mindset, this idea that the world is moving quicker, right? So all the examples I'm taking you through, they're just going to get accelerated. More and more companies are going to die quicker, right? So if you're testing and learning, you're getting into that mind frame of, okay, we need to be looking at our product and changing our business model, just being aware of what's going on. So I actually think it's those smaller companies that perhaps aren't going to solve all of our problems, but actually in terms of the culture and in terms of the way we think, they're really important to be working with. Drop me an email and I'd love to have you involved. Okay.